praise God. There's nothing you can have that's more valuable than the presence of God on all of you. Praise God. Everybody good today?
Amen.
Hallelujah. See, we're here. We're going to be out in the rain. We want to get a blessing today. Hallelujah. Those who laid up in the bed ain't going to get the blessing we're going to get, right? We're going to be in the book of Mark again this morning. Chapter 9, Mark 9. We're going to continue on with the series about faith. The title of the series is Faith Matters. Faith Matters. Hallelujah. So, like I said last week, we want to get back to some of the foundations of Christian life, Christian living, right? Praise God. So we're going to take you back and we're going to lay that foundation again for those of you who've never been laid, and then for those of you where this foundation has already been laid, we're just going to reinforce it. Hallelujah. Right? Hallelujah. You there? Say amen.
Hallelujah.
Let's just start with a prayer. Father God, we just thank you for this time here today. We thank you for your blessings on us. We thank you for bringing out to your house. And Father God, for the opportunity to come out and really serve you and bless you and just be with like-minded people. We just glorify you. We know that this word is going to come out, Father God, unhindered by any plan of the enemy, Father, and that we are going to use it, put it to use, Father, where our lives are going to be changed because your word entered our life today, Father. We just claim that right now. We believe it in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. So we come with open hearts, right? Open hearts. The Bible, Jesus kept saying in the New Testament, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. Right? Praise God. He wasn't talking about these ears. He was talking about your spiritual ears. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and get started into the verse. I don't have a scripture reading this morning. I'm just going to kind of continue on from where we left off, and we'll get a little bit of scripture today as we go along. Praise you. I'm so excited. From Mark 9. And we're going to start. Well, I'm just going to kind of go over some things we went over last week first. In verse 22 of Mark 9, first of all, just to go back to what was going on here. So Jesus comes down from the mountain, and some man approaches him, and he's desperate because his son is got a demonic spirit a new spirit, a dumb spirit, the Bible calls it. And he said, "Your disciples, I took it to the disciples, and they cannot cast it out." Right. So then the father says to Jesus, "If you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us." Right. And so Jesus responded. He says, "If you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes." Now we just gonna need to meditate on that. All things are possible. Let's say, all things are possible to him who believes, him or her who believes. Hallelujah. All things are. That's so powerful. Just meditate on that. Let that come up in your spirit when you're home. You're doing your dishes. You're doing whatever. Just let that spirit that come up in your spirit. All things are possible when you're facing something that seems impossible to you from a worldly sense. It's not impossible because the Bible says all things are possible to him who believes, right? And so we talked about, you know, some of the wrong thinking that we Christians, and I'm talking about Christians, I'm not talking about the world, I'm talking about us. Some of the wrong thinking that is prevalent in the Christians of today, believers, is that we put things on God. Everything's on God, and we think that we have nothing to do with bringing to pass the promises of God in our lives, or just to get us through whatever situation we're going through. And that's an erroneous thinking, okay? And then the other thing we say is, "Oh, well, I'm waiting on God," you know? And so we Christians, we use it, but it's really kind of like an excuse. "I'm waiting on God." "How long have you been waiting, sister?" "Oh, well, 30 years. Any day now, though." 3 years. You know, any day now, though, right? And so it's wrong thinking. And so Jesus right here is telling this man, "You know what? I want to do this for you. I really do. But you're going to have to have some faith here. Okay? You're going to have to have some faith. Okay?" And then the boy's father says, "I believe, help my unbelief." So, you know, there was some unbelief here. But what we said last week was, at least Jesus saw that this man was, at least he was chose to believe. He was willing to believe. And yes, there was some unbelief there, but because he was willing to believe, Jesus says, "Yeah, you granted him his request. Praise God. Hallelujah. Okay? He honored his request. He healed the man's son, and because he chose to believe. Okay? So, and then we talked about how we love and give it because we need the faith, right? So there were two things that were going with this man. Thank you. One is that he thought that it was all put on Jesus. And secondly, his faith was not developed. Remember, we talked about that. And so, but we said that God has given each of us, and it's in the Bible, a measure of faith. Romans 12:3. He's giving us some faith, right? So, but however, we take what he's given us, right? And we develop it. We grow our faith, praise God, right? We have to grow our faith, okay? And then we talked about the importance, how important faith was. You know, the Bible says it's impossible to please God without faith. Okay, there's what else in the Bible does it say that it's impossible to please God without? I haven't seen anything that it says. Only faith, okay? It doesn't say, the Bible doesn't say it's impossible to please God without prayer. It's impossible to please God without going to church. It's impossible to please God without, you know, loving on people. No, the one thing that God said is impossible to please him without his faith. Okay, so that's how important faith is. Okay, he wants us to have it. Okay, and then we read how in Matthew 17, the same story, how the disciples came to Jesus. Both of these interpretations of the story, it says that they came to him privately. Okay, after they were alone with Jesus, and said, "Why couldn't we cast out that spirit?" Okay, and so Jesus said, you know, in Matthew 17, because of your unbelief. So Jesus says, you didn't have enough faith. That's what was going on there. And then he tells them, he gives them one thing that they can do for their faith to grow. Okay, remember? And that was in Matthew 19:20. It says, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. So it starts with your saying, people of God. Remember what the Bible says in the book of Proverbs? Life and death is in the power of what? The tongue. Life or death. It says you choose. You know, what are you talking? What words are you speaking? Are you speaking words of victory? Are you speaking words of belief? Or are you speaking words of doubt? Are you speaking words of death? You know, I'm so sick. Okay? Oh, I'm never going to get out of this situation. I'm never going to find a job. My children are never going to behave the way they're supposed to behave. No, those are speaking words of death. You know what you're doing when you speak words of death? You're keeping that situation alive. Your words are powerful, people, God. Your words are powerful. Okay, so we have to start believing that. And at the very least, if you're not comfortable speaking words of positive words over your situations, please, at least don't speak that, okay? At least shut your mouth, okay? When you feel yourself wanting to say something negative about your situation, just sip it. Hallelujah. Go eat a donut or something, okay? Don't let those words come up in your mouth, because all you're doing, again, is you're bringing, keeping that situation where it's at, or even making it worse, right? Praise God. Hallelujah. Okay, anybody learning something? Okay, then we talked about Mark 11, the famous Mark 11, 22-24. So Jesus answered and said to them, "Have faith in God, for surely I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things he says will be done, he will say, he will have whatever he says. Therefore I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them." Hallelujah. Okay? So he's saying to them, again, the same thing I just said. When you want something, say you want it. Claim it. Believe it. Receive it. Hallelujah. Praise God. And don't speak words of death, okay? Because people, God, here's the thing. Faith is the key. Faith is the key. That's going to open the door to your prayer. Faith is the key. I didn't say it, the Bible says it. I wish it was different. I wish I could just sit on my couch and, you know, eat bonbons all day and not even speak the word of God or, you know, no, but if God said no, okay? Because remember what he said, we are soldiers in the Lord's army, okay? Now, a soldier can't just go on and, you know, when they go to boot camp, they can't just lay up in the bed all day, can they?
No.
Okay, no. I mean, before even the sunlight is out, they are up, right? they're up, you know, they're doing their drills, they're doing what they have to do, right? They're not gonna, they can't even eat what they wanna eat, okay? I mean, they can't, they are being trained, hallelujah. And so just keep that mindset. You know what, when the Holy Spirit rises up in you and says, you know, go read some word, or go invite your prayer closet and pray, or they put, if you bring somebody to your mind to pray for, you know, don't just brush it off the way. No, just go ahead, because you are your soldiers. You are in training. Say, I'm in training.
I'm
in training. Hallelujah. I do what they tell, what the Lord tells me to do, because I am a soldier in training. He's raising up soldiers, people. God, he's not better. You know, but you can't be no man, you can't be Christian and think that you're going to have the breakthroughs that God wants you to have. No, hallelujah. You got to be in there. You got to put on that whole armor. Hallelujah. You got to speak words of faith. Hallelujah. You got to pray. You got to believe. You got to declare. You got to buy. Hallelujah. All those things we are required to do as Christians. Okay? Because we have an enemy. Okay? We have an enemy that's trying to destroy us. That's trying to destroy our children. But we can't let that happen. God has equipped us. Okay, when you go into the military, do you got to buy your own uniforms? No, do you have to buy your own equipment? No, you don't have to do it. God has already given you everything you need. You know, those soldiers, they get everything they need to do what the military wants them to do, praise God, what they have to do for their country. They get everything they need. Okay, and this is the same with God. He has equipped you with everything you need. You just gotta develop it, people, God. You just gotta believe it. You gotta have faith in yourself. You have to have faith to know that what God has said I can do, I can do. He's filled me with His Spirit, hallelujah. He's given me His Word. He's given me His Son. He's given me everything I need to have victory in my life. So why am I defeated? Because of me? Say it, because of me? Okay, don't point fingers, okay? Oh, you know, the pastor is not doing this. The pastor didn't pray for me this week. I wanted her to lay hands. I wanted God to tell her that I needed help, but the Holy Spirit didn't tell her. Maybe the Holy Spirit told her, but she didn't listen. No, no, no. Hallelujah. Don't, you can't blame anybody. You got to get up and do it for yourself. Hallelujah. Okay, you are responsible for your spiritual well-being. You want to be a spiritual giant. The only one that can do it is you and God. Okay, but not God alone and not you alone. You and God. It's a partnership. Praise God. Okay? I'm preaching them. Y'all have to know that I'm preaching them. Praise God. Okay? Okay, because here's the bottom line, people, God. We cannot live like the world and expect supernatural results. And when I say you can't live like the world, I'm not saying about you going after sin or whatever. I'm not going to talk about that. I'm talking about you can't be like them. You can't, like, listen to the news and agree with everything they say. Okay? Because they have you all worrying and crying. You know, they're talking about the Dow went down this low. And, oh, Lord Jesus, that goes my retirement. No! No! Talking about all this violence. Oh, my kids are going to be, you know, in danger. No! You know what? You are supernaturally protected. Hallelujah. You are set apart. You are living in the world, but you are not of the world, the Bible says. We are different. Hallelujah. God has chosen us. He's equipped us. He's anointed us. He supernaturally protects you, but you got to stand up and believe it, claim it, receive it. Hallelujah. Well, Pastor, are you kind of more like one of those faith pastors? What's the alternative? You want me to preach that? You gotta go down to that street, that church down the street for that. Not in this church. Not in this church. Hallelujah. No. We speak life here. Hallelujah. I'm giving you tools that the God's revealing to me to equip you to be to everything that you can be in this life, people. God. Hallelujah. So we can't live like the world and think that we're gonna have supernatural results. We have to be like God. God tells us to be, right? We gotta do what He tells us to do, right? You know, the father whose son was tormented by demonic spirits, you know, he had some doubt. You know what? But at least he was willing, and grace comes and makes up the difference, okay? However, we cannot remain faithless. We gotta grow up. We cannot spend our Christian life doubting and speaking words of unbelief, you know. We just can't, you know, and sometimes the world will creep up on it. I remember, like, a couple weeks ago, Sister Talek came and she she had this what looked like a spider bite. And so I looked, I said, oh, that's a spider bite. And I said, you better go to the doctor. You know what? And then I thought about it later. I said, why didn't I just lay hands and rebuke that thing? Okay? I mean, because, you know what? Your pastor fails sometimes. You know, sometimes I feel like the world too. You know, you dare the doctor, go to the doctor. You know what? You know, that guy got really angry with somebody in the Bible because it was a king, one of the Israeli kings, because he got sick and he went to the physician instead of going to God. God said, no, he got mad at him. Okay? So God said, you know what? You're a Christian, you get sick, you come after, you need some prayer or lay hands on yourself. And ain't no doubt. If there's nobody around to pray, you look around and oh, there goes Sister Brian. And I said, you better lay hands on you. You know, she got some things on her. You know, you turn around, your boss over there, there ain't nobody to pray for you. Lay hands on yourself and pray for yourself. You have the power within you. You don't have to wait to get to church. Okay, it's Monday and you got a migraine headache and the church ain't till next Sunday. I'll feel bad for you. You're gonna have that. No, praise God. Lay hands on the name of Jesus. I am healed by the strength of Jesus. Migraine, I command you to leave me. Spirit pain, I command you to leave me. Hallelujah. The kid came home with some pain the other day. And so I went and I laid hands on her and I just rebuked the pain and you know, called forth the word of God. She's healed by the stripes of Jesus. And her friend was over and he was like, you know, and he told her that that sounded like I was doing an exorcism. Well, I was! I was commanding that pain to get the heck out of her body because she doesn't belong to her. She is healed by the stripes of Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, praise God. Don't worry. You know, don't worry about what the world thinks. If you're going to worry about what the world thinks, you ain't going to get anywhere. Because people think you're thinking you're crazy. Sometimes people don't think I'm kind of a little bit out there, but that's okay. They know I'm a pastor. My husband thinks I'm a little bit out there. You know, they talk about the water who are talking about how sick they are. Oh, everybody gets that. Oh, it's flu season. No, it's not. I ain't getting it. I'm not getting it. They were telling me that I'm crazy, but you know, it shuts them up. It shuts them up. Don't talk to me about being sick. I ain't going to get that. Hallelujah. Praise God. Anyway, let me keep on going here. Okay, so, you know, we talked about a couple examples last week of people who were in unbelief. You know, remember the disciples on the boat, they were all full of unbelief. And Jesus chastised them and that. So let's talk a little bit. I want to give you a couple more examples because we got to get this. We're laying the foundation. I'm not going to just put a couple of bricks and say, there's your foundation. No, we got it. We got to spread that cement. Hallelujah. It's got to be a good foundation. Say, thank you, Pastor. Thank you. Say, thank you. You're welcome. Hallelujah. Okay. Remember when Jesus was resurrected, the day he was resurrected, right? You had the women went out to anoint his body, right? You had Mary Magdalene and some others. Mary Magdalene, there were several Marys in the Bible. But Mary went out, and so she gets to the tomb, the tomb's open, Jesus is not there. So she runs and she tells the disciples, his body's not here, okay? And so then, this is in the book of John, and so then the Bible says that Peter and John ran. They ran to the tomb, right? They went in and all they saw were the linen cloths, right? And his handkerchief was folded there. And so, and by the way, do you guys know why the handkerchief was folded? No, there is no, there are, there's nothing in the Bible is there just to be there. Everything that's in the Bible is there for a reason. So if it tells you that the handkerchief was folded, you know, it's for a reason. And so one time I was studying the Bible, I was reading scripture, and I ran across this. I wonder why the handkerchief was folded. And a big booming voice came down. I went to and anyway, I went and I did some research on it, and the reason that that handkerchief was brought was, and let's go ahead and turn to John. I want y'all to see this. But the reason, I'm going to talk a little bit more about John here. But the reason that the handkerchief was quoted was because back in those days, when a man who had servants was eating their meal, and if they got up from the table to go, I don't know, to the restroom or whatever they went to go talk on their cell phone, when they got up from their meal, they would take them. If they were not done with their meal, they didn't want the servants to clear the table. they would fold their napkins and leave it there. So that way the servant always had something to come back. Then if the napkin was not folded, the servant was coming up, okay? So when Jesus left that napkin folded, he says, I'm going to be back. You ain't seen the last of me. I'm going to be back. Hallelujah. Praise God. So anyway, so here comes Peter and John, and they run in, and the Bible says, I'm going to turn here. What do I say to turn? John 20. Okay. The Bible says that when John saw the living apostle in the handkerchief, it says he believed. John believed. The apostle thought of believed, okay? And then later on, after Jesus had seen Mary, whatever, it was the same day, the Bible says in the book of John that they were all in the room and Jesus came and he showed up. Okay, it was later on that day. And the Bible says it was the first day of the week, so it was Sunday. It was Sunday. So they all show up, but Jesus comes among them and they believe, right? Because they've seen him, right? And so then Thomas was absent, okay? Thomas was absent, and then Thomas, when they told Thomas, hey, we've all seen the Lord, we've seen him, he says, I don't believe, okay? He says, unless I'm able to see, you know, the holes in his hands and put my finger in the side where they cut him there, I'm not going to believe, okay? So Thomas chose not to believe. Say, shame on you, Thomas. He chose not to believe, even though the others had given him the report that they had all seen him. He chose not to believe. Thomas had zero faith. Okay? Zero faith. Okay? So then the next week, Jesus shows up again, and this time, and you know what happened? You know what Thomas missed it? Thomas missed church. It was Sunday, right? He was supposed to be up in the church. And if he had been up in the church, it was the first day of the week, he would not have missed the Lord. See, when you don't come to the church, you miss the Lord. Hallelujah. When you don't come to the church, you miss a good word from the Lord. You miss the Lord. Hallelujah. God and his word. Jesus is the word of God. And you miss him. So then the next week, and I'm into John 20. I'm about the 24th verse, 25th, 26th verse. The next week, John is there. And so then he says, Jesus is telling John, let's just go ahead and read that. Is it 27?
Yeah.
Okay. Then he said to Thomas, okay, because Thomas is there now, he says, reach your finger here and look at my hands, and reach your hand here and put it into my side. Do not be unbelieving, but believing. And Thomas answered and said to him, my Lord and my God. Jesus said to him, Thomas, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed.
Amen.
You know? That is so powerful. What a powerful statement. And he's talking about you all. You all have the blessing, hallelujah, of God, because you have not seen him physically with your eyes, but you believe. You believe, hallelujah. You know, Thomas's motto was, you know, seeing is believing. You heard that? Seeing is believing. That was Thomas' motto. But you know what? That's a wrong way to look at Jesus. Hallelujah. You gotta know he exists. You gotta know that he's with you. You gotta know that he's there to help you. Hallelujah. So Thomas didn't believe. He had zero faith. Okay? So John chose to believe. Thomas chose not to believe. Okay? And so the funny thing about Thomas and about him is that for the rest of the Bible, you don't hear Thomas. He's only mentioned in the book of Acts because he says he was in the upper room with the others. You don't hear him, his miracles. I mean, I'm sure he went out because all the disciples after that, they went and they spread the gospel. But you don't hear anything. You don't hear him, you know, he's not traveling with Paul. He's not traveling with Barnabas. You know, he's not traveling with any of them. You know, Luke doesn't mention him. You know, did they travel together and do miracles together? No. What about John? John went on to write the Gospel of John that we're reading right now. He went on to write three epistles and went on to write the book of Revelation. God used John so powerfully to write the book of Revelation. I mean, God, he lived to a good old age and he used him. He took him up to heaven and showed him things that no man, no living person had ever seen, gave him prophecy. Hallelujah. He was John in a wonderful, miraculous way. And I believe it was because John had strong faith. John chose. chose to believe, even in the midst of his not seeing, not feeling, not hearing, not tasting, right? He chose to believe. That's powerful. People of God, that's powerful. Okay, now let me say one more story that I want to share with you, because this one too is so powerful. Let's turn real quick to the book of Hebrews. I'm going to share this with you. I told you I have some scriptures for you today. Hallelujah. I'm having a good time up here with the Lord. How about you all?
Amen.
Don't be thinking about what you got in the oven at home. You know what? God will take care of it. And okay, Hebrews 3:16-19. I'm going to go ahead and start with verse 16. It says, "For who having heard rebelled? Indeed, was it not all who came out of Egypt led by Moses? Now with whom was he angry 40 years? Was it not with those who sinned, whose corpses fell in the wilderness? And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but to those who did not obey?" Okay, so who's he talking about? Oh, let's go to 19. So we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. Who was he talking about? Israelites over in the wilderness. He was talking about. He was angry for them for 40 years. I don't want God to be angry with me for 4 seconds. Much less 40 years, okay? Remember in Numbers, Moses sends out the 12 spies, right? Okay, and then they come back and 10 of them, they do what? They give a bad report. They say, they all agree the lambs, oh, flowing with milk and honey, big fruits, wonderful place, but it has giants. And so they came back saying, oh, we will never defeat these giants, we're like grasshoppers in their eyes, all this negativity, okay? And so so God gets angry with them for that. I mean, yeah, he split the Red Sea for them, he poured water out of a rock for them, he rained down manna from heaven. I mean, come on now! And they're doubting that God can take them, can defeat the giants on their behalf after he told them, I promise that I'm going to take you into the promised land?
Yeah.
Come on now! And so, but there were two of them. Remember, who were they? Caleb and Joshua. Praise God! I have some Bible students in my car in this church service. Two of them, Caleb and Joshua, believed. And they said, we can take them on. We can defeat them. Come on, let's go, guys. And they, you know what other people wanted to do? They wanted to stone Joshua and Caleb. That's how fearful they were. People got that these 10 leaders, because they were all leaders, and he put one leader from each tribe, 12 of them. These 10 of them, they discouraged everyone else. People, that doubt is a disease. Doubt is a disease. We see it everywhere. Doubt is a disease. The world is full of doubt. It's a disease. Don't catch it. Tell somebody and say, don't catch it. Don't catch the disease of doubt. It's praise God, but let's not have that. Okay? And then this is what God says about Caleb. And you don't have to turn it down. I'm just going to read it. In Numbers 14:24, he says, "But my servant Caleb has a different attitude than the others have." Tell somebody and say, have a different attitude. Tell somebody you need an attitude adjustment. Caleb had a different attitude. Okay? People, I look at some of y'all faces and I think, I need a different attitude, but not all. You know what? The Lord got you. Caleb had a different attitude. Okay? And then he goes on to say how Caleb was loyal to him. He's going to bring him into this land. His descendants are going to possess their full share of the land. So what happened? What happened to Caleb and Joshua? Yes! Hallelujah! Praise God! Somebody pat her on the back. Joshua, hit her across the head. Hallelujah! Praise God! Okay, so Caleb and Joshua were the only ones of the adult people that made it into the promised land. They had to go for 40 years until that adult generation died off. Raised up the children to go into the promised land. And Caleb and Joshua were the only ones that went in, okay? And then Caleb gets all this special land. And listen to what he says. He's 85 years old by the time he makes it in there. And you might think, 85? In 2 years, he's going to be dead. No, you know what? Because this is what he says. He said, "I am as strong as I was when Moses sent me to spy out the land. Praise God! He was 85 and acting like a 45-year-old. Praise God! He was acting like he was young. He said, I was strong now as I was when I worked and when God sent me to go spy out the land. God preserved his age. Why? Because he had faith. Hallelujah. Because he believed in his God. He had faith and God preserved him and gave him all this special land. And what about Joshua? Oh, Joshua. Not you, Joshua. I got two Joshuas that I love. God used Joshua to succeed Moses. Joshua was actually the one that God raised up to take the people into the promised land. He took all because Joshua believed. Hallelujah. You know, I believe that if Joshua had doubted like those other 10, God would not have been able to use him. He would have died and never see the land, much less got promoted to take people into the promised land. People of God, faith will promote you.
Amen.
Say, touch somebody and say, faith will promote you. It will promote you. You didn't say that with your enthusiasm, Brother Jim, so say it again. Faith will promote you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'll leave you behind. Because faith is promoting me. Hallelujah. Faith will promote you. You see what happens in the Bible. You see, and there's many more examples. The person who didn't have faith, didn't believe God could help them, guess what? He got left behind. But the people who rose up and have faith in God, God promoted them. God gave them breakthroughs. God caused them to be leaders. Hallelujah. People, God, it's worth having faith. It's worth developing your faith. It is worth speaking words of life and stop speaking those death words. Hallelujah. Because that's what's going to get your faith to go. Hallelujah. Praise God. If somebody want to run around the room, just go ahead. Okay, I'm going to conclude. I'm finishing up here. Let's go ahead. Actually, I'm just going to go ahead and read it. Back into Mark 9. Remember, we're back to the story of the man with the demonic ridden child. And he wasn't a child, so he was a man by this point. But he had been destroyed basically by this demon since he was a child. Okay, he had been tormented since he was a child, right? But now he's a man, and God gave him the breakthrough. But remember, the disciples again, they asked Jesus. When they were alone, why could we not cast it out? Okay, they couldn't understand because, you know, remember, God had given them authority.
Yeah.
Remember, we talked about He gave them authority and He gave them power, right? Dunamis and exousia to cast out demons. So here they are, and they can't do it, and they're wondering, why didn't it work, Lord? Why didn't it work? And Jesus said to them, "This is what He says: This kind can come out by nothing but prayer and fasting." I used to read that and think, if you give me authority to cast out a demon, why can't I just cast them out? And you know, some Bibles leave out the word fast. Some believe that it was never in the original scripture, so the newer versions just say like prayer, okay? To me, it doesn't intimidate me anymore that that's in here. Because you know what? What Jesus was saying. He wasn't saying that this demonic spirit was so strong, so powerful, that it could only be cast out with prayer and fasting. What he was saying is that a determined enemy must be met with an equally determined faith. What he was saying is go fast and pray because your faith is weak. Go fast and pray because you're full of fear. Go fast and pray so that you can start believing that the power I gave you is adequate. Go fast and pray so that you can believe that my word is true and that when I say that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world, then you will believe that. Go fast and pray so that you can believe that nothing shall be impossible unto you. Hallelujah. Go fast and pray so that greater things than I have done will you do.
Amen. Yeah.
Because you know what? Here's the thing, people. God, I'm almost finished. I promise you, I'm almost finished. When you are a baby Christian, when you're new to the faith, like the disciples were when they first started talking with Jesus, he is going to give you the grace to do whatever you have to do, because he gave it to me. When I was a baby Christian, it was like, oh, I got this thing. You know, I would pray for something, it will come to pass, or I would say something, it will come to pass. And then as the years went on and I started growing more in the faith, it became harder and harder to see some of the breakthroughs. And that's because God says, you know, and some of the things that I was trying back then, like, I remember I did this, that when I was, you know, so maybe that'll work again. And it didn't work. Because what God, in God's kingdom, the way it works is that just like a soldier coming in, they go through boot camp, okay? They're training them. They're being trained, okay? But later on, when they've been in the military for 10 years, they need to know already how to use those weapons. They need to know what to do when they're out in combat. Hallelujah. And that's the same thing with us people, God. God will give you the grace. He gave this man grace and healed his son, even though he was an unbeliever. And he will do that for you when you are a baby person. But as you start to grow, hallelujah, God said, get off of the milk and get onto the meat. Get in my word. Meditate on my scripture. Start believing that the things that I said for you are possible to you, are possible to you. Start exercising your faith. In other words, grow up, Christian. Amen. Grow up and you will see not only the things that you used to see, but greater things, those windows that you'll be able to do. And that's why he said to them, you know what, I ain't just giving you the power. I gave you the power, now you have to exercise it. You need to go fast and pray. That power comes, you can have that faith and that power that you need today. You know that it's going to happen, go and do it. Hallelujah. I'm not intimidated by that scripture anymore. I know God gave me a revelation of what he was saying. Hallelujah. This kind can only come out by prayer and fasting. This kind of what? This kind of faith.
Amen.
This kind of belief can only happen by prayer and fasting. So you get on your knees, go and get in your prayer closet. Go ahead and fast if you need to. Got to get there, hallelujah, and that's what he's telling us today, people. God, it's time to get on the way, get into the word of God, hallelujah. Because you know what, here, and I'm finishing, prayer doesn't change God, people. It changes us.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He wants to change us in our situation. Where he wants. We need to faith in order to have it. Must develop it. In order to develop it, we must be forth to victory, and we must pray, and we must fast, and fast, and that's what God needs us to do. Hallelujah. So that we can have that faith that we need to have everything and to do everything for the kingdom of God. That when somebody walks in here and they're sick, that we can just lay hands on them, see them, Father. Hallelujah. When we ain't got money to pay this or whatever, we just, you know, just call forth that money into it. And praise God in their palms. Hallelujah. When your children are acting up, you just kind of rebuke that thing out for them. And you know what? They all straightened up again. We need to have that. Hallelujah. I know maybe some of you are facing some terrible situations in your life, but you know, God says that he's equipped you to handle it. Okay? And you're here today and you learned a little bit more, laying that foundation. You will come back next week and we'll learn a little bit more. But in the meantime, you will die. Don't go from Sunday to Sunday without a word. It ain't gonna work. Don't go from Sunday to Sunday without a word. Get into it. Hallelujah. Start memorizing some of those scriptures that when something happens in the job and you have your Bible handy, that you can just claim that word of God and see that thing come to pass. Hallelujah. It's powerful. Y'all learn anything today? Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you. We glorify you. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your grace. We thank you, Father God, that nothing's impossible for you, Father God. We ask you to help us to develop our faith, Father God. Oh, Father, bring up situations that are going to help us to practice that. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. We glorify your name. We thank you, Father God. God, thank you for this time with you. And we just thank you for all that you've done and all that you continue to do in our lives. Father, glorify your name. Amen. Hallelujah. What a wonderful Savior. Praise God. Does anybody want